Julia.
Yeah.
So good.
Yeah.
Amazing.
You know, she told me before she started, I said, this thing is right here.
Yeah.
And she's like, don't worry, I'm not going to hit it that hard.
No. Just
tap it. And then the song starts, and it's, that's all you're hitting.
Yeah, that's all you're hitting.
Oh, my goodness.
Well, when you decided to sit there.
Because exactly. The China was originally on that side, but you moved it when Jerry
yeah.
said
right, only right, when right. he sat
just
there,
just being
yeah.
kind to me.
Yeah.
Julia, your footwork has just, like, from the first time I saw you play.
Yeah, years ago.
Till now, it's getting insane.
Oh, thank you. Yeah.
Very nice Incredible. Work.
Yeah, yeah, it feels really good. And, like, this is not even my own kit, and I feel pretty comfortable.
Sounds good.
Sounds great at home.
Sounds yeah. awesome.
Well, to all of you out there watching, we're here for our first week of International Drum Month.
Don't push
we're here button. With Julia Geaman, a longtime Drumeo instructor, Drumeo coach. She has a bunch of content with us here on Drumeo. And of course, Jared and Dave.
Hi.
Joining us as well. Here for the the comedy.
Yeah, what are you comedy. Here for? We got pedals,
Dave's and they've got pedals.
Calls, which is great, yeah.
No,
he's, giving, he's giving away free pedals.
No, I'm not giving away free pedals.
He's got a whole library at home and he's going to pawn them off.
Yeah. You're giving away free pedals?
I'm going to be pedals. Do you want me to give away these ones?
They're yours.
No. We've got a...
We actually are giving away pedals.
Look at
no
this.
No way.
That's a brand new, too.
This is brand new. Huge shout out to Yamaha for... hooking us up with this, but
I think these are the best pedals ever created.
Yeah. I love them.
I know some people disagree.
Yeah, yeah, some people I think do, but
Brandon,
I'm not going to share my opinion.
What?
Oh, come on.
For all of you watching, what type of double pedals do you use? I think we should take a poll. I'm going to put a poll.
Let's do it in the chat.
And we're going to see who thinks Yamaha pedals are the best.
Let's do it.
How do we get a poll in here?
And then, if the Yamaha wins, you will forever play them for the rest of eternity.
Yes.
Yeah.
If you want,
yeah.
if you like the Yamaha, only text Jared.
Go ahead. 604.
Rowan, carry on. Can you put up a poll in the YouTube chat, my man?
He's
Perfect.
On it.
Perfect.
So, if you want to win these pedals, Yamaha FP9 set of double pedals, and the brand new Drumeo QuietKick doubles, which you can see Jared and Dave both have set up below them. You gotta stick around to the end of the stream. So we'll be here for about an hour, and we're gonna do a draw.
The best double kick players yes. in the world right here.
And Julia, you're gonna put them through the ringer later on.
No, it'll be easy. It'll be right, totally right. fine.
No, we're gonna basically
burn our feet, burn our shins.
Gonna practice or give us some exercises, and we're gonna see if we can keep up.
We'll see.
Love
we'll
it.
See. Yeah, we'll see That's if good. We can keep up.
Love it. So we're talking about double bass. And I guess to start off, Julia, the reason we brought you in is because you're a fantastic double bass player. So I guess what got you into double bass in the beginning? Was it a certain drummer, a certain record? What yeah. was it that got you into it?
Yeah, I started playing double kick like right away. I didn't really care about anything else. It was mostly like death, like symbolic,
yeah.
that album. I remember hearing, I think, 1,000 Eyes. Mm-hmm. I know you guys are huge death metal fans. You probably know what
I actually
I'm
love
about.
That record.
But you,
it's
yeah.
such a great record.
Yeah, because it's actually kind of jazzy and weird. And I just remember hearing the double kick for the first time, and I'm like, that doesn't sound like a human being. Like, I don't understand how someone is doing that. And it really fascinated me. Like, it, like genuinely, I was like super curious, and like I didn't understand how. So yeah. I just like, I walked to the music store, and I just... started taking lessons.
Nice.
Yeah. So yeah.
Most teachers say like if you start drums, you start in a practice pad or a snare drum.
Yeah.
But you're like, no. First things first,
yeah.
go get a double bass
yeah.
pedal.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Listen listen to the years.
It's all about Gene Hogan.
I love it. I love it.
Yeah.
Do you find that if you had started double bass later it'd have been tougher, like quite a bit more difficult?
Well, I honestly like after about a year and a half, I took it seriously. Like I actually explored the hi-hat pedal, like mm-hmm. I honestly never even put my foot on there.
For a year.
Crazy.
Basically.
Dave never that. Uses it to this day.
I don't even put a hi-hat.
That's why
head.
You think he's yeah. so awesome.
I have four double bass pedals on
there. Yeah, like extra pedal over here.
Yeah,
I mean, after I realized I wanted to do it, I went into it seriously and like, okay, I'm gonna challenge myself to not play double kick, which is horrible for a metal drummer. Like, you can't do that
right.
to...
Yeah.
to a metal drummer, but I took the time later to get into it. But I think because I started with what I was really interested in, it got me playing.
Yeah.
And that's why whenever I have students and they're like, I want to play this, instead of me saying like, no, you need to practice your rudiments, I just go with it because
nice.
If they get hooked, then I can sneak in like the rudiments and all the other like basic stuff that you need that I also think is important, but I just went with like what I felt and what I wanted to do.
You know, good teachers make like the teaching almost invisible, especially the boring stuff, right?
Yeah, you gotta kind of trick them, psychologically trick them into practicing or something. Yeah,
it's totally true. That's awesome.
And Dave, you're a big double bass player.
I love double bass. I bought my first double bass pedal probably my second year of playing, and that was only because I could only afford it then.
Yeah.
But yeah, I started relatively early.
I didn't even know that you played double bass. Yeah.
Yeah. No, I played dance.
You hide it. You
I got like into. I
show
got
the
into.
World
yeah. Well, there's many videos out there of me doing double bass
really?
Stuff. Oh yeah, tons. But yeah, I got into like prog rock was what got me into it, and then I got into like the heavier death metal and stuff later on. But it was like the Porcupine Tree and the Dream Theater and. Even Rush and bands like that can be double bass. Yeah.
Dave taught the double bass lessons on freedromlessons.com.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I've seen those videos.
You're making fire, okay.
With the legendary Dave Locks.
And just the cheesiest beats and fills, like they were so bad. But that was years ago.
Yeah.
Is there a montage of this?
Probably.
Yeah, I'm sure. I'm sure there's a clip. We might actually watch it later.
When I was in your seat, that was what I would do. I'd be like, "Okay, guys, so you know," I'd always rub my hands together. You said it was like
naked. Like I said.
So the original double bass player, everyone always references Louis Belson, right?
Yeah.
But I was just chatting with Kyle, I think, at lunch, and he was saying, "Buddy Rich used to play double bass."
I was chatting with him too, and he said that Louis was first, and then I think in like 1949 or something, Buddy, to spite Louis, was like, "I'm gonna do this solo with only bass drums and play like some jazz tune on it." So I think there might be a clip of that later too, but yeah, I think Louis was like the first guy who like popularized it.
Right.
Which is crazy. Most people don't think that it came from jazz.
Yeah.
Right.
No.
But like two bass drums,
two bass drums.
A double kick. That was like a cheater pedal, as some people call them.
Yeah. Some people.
Yeah.
Who calls it cheater pedal?
I do call it that sometimes. Guilty as charged. The only times I do.
Such a hater.
I said it's trollio.
It's trollio. Right?
So the only time I do that is like when me and Dave have like a drum dial or something, and we're going and it's all good, and then he throws in this double bass thing. It's like, come on, man, what are you doing?
I can't touch your speed on your hands, but I can definitely touch your speed on the feet. So I'm like, all right, if you're gonna do the cheater hands, I'm gonna do the cheater pedals.
Cheater hands? It's like you have.
See, Julia, later on, we have to do like a speed challenge to see who's actually faster.
Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
At total base, I lose 100%.
Oh, well,
do you think your hands are faster? Your hands are faster than his feet, right?
Oh, it's not even close.
I would hope so.
It's not even close.
Oh, that's great.
So the poll, what double pedal did you use? Thank you, Rowan, for putting that up.
Where are we at?
Yamaha 13%, DW 24%. Is that what you use? I apologize for that. And Pearl, 19%, and then 43% said other.
And I bet you the majority of those others are probably the Tama. I think that's the
Tama,
we could have put Tama in, but
Iron Cobras,
I think that one
Cobras.
Is the most popular.
Yeah. Those are good pedals.
Tama is
just
great.
Speed Cobras?
Yeah.
The Eliminators, too, is great.
Right. Just want to say a big thank you to everyone out here in YouTube chat, as well as in the Drumeo chat. So for those of you who are watching on Drumeo, we're also streaming this on YouTube. And there's a bunch of questions in the Drumeo chat from the members. And so if you're on YouTube and you're like, I want to ask a question, I want to get a shout out or whatever, we're just going to take care of our members first.
I love it.
Yeah, that's just kind of how we got to roll. And there's actually a lot of questions in here. So Brandon, you're supposed to be guiding this and hosting this.
I am. You're going to keep us on track.
Take the lead, Brandon.
This is usually Kyle's job for these.
Take the
lead. And I'm going to keep us on track. Speaking of which, right now, we're going to watch a clip of the history of double bass drumming.
Nice.
So let's check this out. Let's load up the clip. And
when did we make this?
We're going to do a little thing in Old Man River that you may find just a little bit unusual. We hope you like Old Man River.
Wow.
Nice.
What a crazy evolution.
Wild. From like even like the open bass drums in the 50s and the 40s, and you just hear like all the resonance through the kick.
Yeah.
And then at the end, just like straight triggers. Like it's crazy though, the whole transition.
What were those bass drums? Were they like 26?
I think the Cozy Powell one. Yeah, like 26s.
Yeah. I have a mid-40s Slingerland kit that had the original drum head on it.
Yeah.
And I took it home and I was playing double bass with it.
Oh,
and
no.
The drum head. The
no. I was going to say it turned to dust as soon as you played it.
No, but it's hard to play.
The calfskin, like.
Yeah, it's hard to play on that because it's so waffly. Right?
Yeah, yeah. I know a band, Pound, the dude plays, I forget what the small bass drum is, but I think it's like a 24, and then he swivels his chair and plays on a 30. So he has like kind of two setups. Like that.
How high would your beater have to be?
Right?
It literally hit like the bottom third.
So, Julia, what are your, like, just quickly go over your setup, like tension, distance from the drum head, just because that's a question so many drummers ask.
Everybody asks, and I'm like not very particular about it. As long as it's not like super low, like, you know, when you get your ankle or the shin.
Do we have a foot cam? There we go, we got a foot cam.
Yeah. Basically just a 45 degree angle, just about, and anything else I'm pretty much okay with. A little bit of tension, not too loose, but I'm not like so particular where I like measure and get the exact same tension. I just kind of, I feel it out.
Well, okay, what about your left pedal?
Yeah.
You're right footed. Is when you were first developing, did you crank up the tension to kind of build
up? I thought it was the pedal's fault.
Right. Always,
Well, it always is, right?
Yeah. I mean,
yeah, I thought it was the gear. I was like, it feels so different, and I was like, maybe, like, I was trying to be, like, scientific about it. Like, well, it's over here, and it's further away from that, and, like, I don't know what happened, but I just worked a little bit more on my left foot, and that helped. It still feels different. Like, it still feels slower.
Do you feel like your left foot is always chasing your right foot?
Not anymore, but it used to feel like that. I think what I did is I learned to play louder with my left foot. So, like, just like pushing a little bit harder with my left foot in order to even it out. And now they feel pretty even, or I'm just used to it at this point. Right.
That reminds me of like the when I saw the Weckl thing where you accent the second of the double.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah, like when you're playing double kick, I think a lot of drummers sound like this at first. Through the speakers, it just sounds like an eighth note.
Yeah.
So I just learned to kind of push my left foot more, like a little bit more like that. And now I'm just comfortable with the way that that feels.
Yeah.
So I don't think about it anymore.
And when you speed it up, that starts to just normalize, right?
It like turns into more of like this weird, I don't know. It just kind of vibrates, I guess, after a while.
Yeah. I find clarity is like such an important part when you're playing these fast patterns, right? Like when you first came here, you were an amazing drummer, but the difference between that and now was it's pretty remarkable, right?
Oh,
so like what is your, what, especially in the clarity, I think, and just like the precision in that you're doing it. So what was your routine there? Are we going to go into that now, Brandon?
Actually, I wanted to ask two great questions that came in from the Drumeo community.
More.
First one is from P-Dub. They say, hi, Julia, nice playing. How come you prefer double pedal rather than two bass drums?
I used to play two bass drums. Honestly, just touring with two bass drums is more work.
Yeah, right?
Sucks.
I think you'll learn I'm pretty lazy. And I really try to make it as easy as possible for myself so I can actually enjoy what I'm doing. Like, I want to enjoy, you know, playing. Yeah. So just, like, simplify my setup as much as possible. I think you get used to one way or the other. So I got used to two kicks, and I think they were just further apart, and it changed where my hi-hat was. So it was just kind of more set up wider.
Gotcha.
And I don't have super long limbs, so I kind of, when I went back to a single kick, I was like, oh, this is actually more comfortable.
Nice.
So I like the setup. I sort of like the asymmetry of it, even though people say the exact opposite. They like the symmetry of two bass drums.
Yeah.
It looks really cool, but I don't know. I just like it sort of like this now.
Right.
And yeah, I think I just got used to the way one bass drum feels.
Yeah.
It feels comfortable for me now, and it bounces really well.
Nice. One other question that came in from MW, hopefully I'm saying that right. They ask, do you usually have a dominant leg as you tend to with your hands when using double pedals?
Yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah, yeah, definitely. Like I'm 100% right-footed and I still feel that. I think like I play as good as my left foot can play and then my right foot can go up above that, but I just don't push perform at that in that area. So yeah. I just try to push my speed and my accuracy, but I still feel definitely that my left foot is not as responsive as my right foot. It's just how everybody is, I think.
I know when Simon was out, we did a whole like double bass course and he has this whole philosophy on like leading with the left because his left is a timekeeper. Like Dave, did you ever play like left foot lead or?
Never.
Always right?
Left foot lead. I know like there's a lot of people that do limb assignments. So anytime you're on the E's or the A's, it's on your left. And then the one and the A's are on your right. But not for me. I was always right foot dominant. So that's what I always led with.
Yeah.
Like leading with the left foot in double kick or
in
like on the
kick.
High?
Oh, yeah. So all like the downbeats on the left foot.
I used to play beats with my left foot to give my right foot a break because I would like push myself beyond what I could play and my right foot would just be dying. So I started learning how to play with my left foot because I like couldn't move my right foot anymore.
Yeah.
So that's really cool when you're playing and sort of playing the bass drum with the left foot.
I think I think the only one I've ever played like left foot lead is the Hopper Teacher. Double bass shuffle.
Okay,
for whatever reason, that one when I play it left foot lead, it just seems to anchor better. But that's like the only one I play left foot lead.
I can see that because you're playing the quarter notes.
Yeah.
Or that one. Da, da,
da. Yeah. Yeah.
But like anything like broken and syncopated or whatever, it's always like right foot lead.
Yeah.
Which is, who knows why. Was there any of those clips that you had seen before or hadn't seen? Like some of the old Louis ones or?
I've never seen that.
No?
I like the Louis one where it's like he was doing those Mike Portnoy combos before anyone else was doing it. He's
like, cool. I don't think I've seen those ones.
I know it's the, like looking back, even like the Portnoy back to the Louis Belson stuff. It's like with John Bonham when they talk about like the Bonham triplets. He obviously made them popular, but guys like Elvin and Max Roach were even doing that like decades before. But it's funny how like one drummer really like takes it, like Mike, and like turns that into like a really popular thing.
Well, it's cool because you get to see like the evolution of where this idea started and then where it is today.
Yeah.
And it's so different, right? Because right back then they had two bass drums and two single pedals. And now we have double pedals, like highly engineered to go like super fast.
Yeah.
All the kit and all the recording gear is so much better. So it just sounds so much better. And I wonder what the next idea like that is going to be on drum set.
Mm-hmm.
Like there was a stack, stacks have kind of come and they were never there in the 80s and 90s, right? But
or
what else?
The ozone symbols.
Yeah, the holy symbols.
Yeah.
So,
Julia, why don't we, let's get into some actual like playing.
Okay.
We got Jared and Dave with the quiet kicks and some double pedals. So teach us something.
Pro double kick players.
Do it.
Ready to go.
Do it.
Yeah, I think I wanted to do something a little bit different. I kind of want to challenge you guys. I don't know how you're feeling, but actually, like, taking the idea.
No. You got to make this really difficult.
Jeez, I know.
I'm so jealous. You're so jealous. taking the idea of, like, alternating, if you think about double kick, I think a lot of people think, like, you're supposed to play singles like all the way through, and it's sort of like, what else do you have to practice? Like, I think some people maybe get bored or discouraged because they don't know sort of what else to play. Like, if you think of just playing single stroke rolls in your hands, that seems so like such a tragedy. Like, why would you just do that?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I remember going through some weird patterns just to play around, and just because I'm sort of fidgety as well, like I would put my rudiment pad on my snare and I would just sort of play different patterns and stuff, like little three-stroke roughs or, you know, flams or whatever, just to kind of keep my whole body moving.
Yeah.
And I think a really good one to start off with is just an alternating three-stroke rough, just right, left, right, left, right, left. Just 1EN, 2EN, 3EN, 4EN. And you guys just have those quiet pads there and no sticks and no pads, so you're gonna pretend with your hands, because the idea is to be able to keep that going while playing something on top of it.
Like a beat?
You start off with just anything. You can just tap along.
Okay.
You can play exactly what you're playing. I think my drum instructor said, like, if you want to play something with your feet, just teach yourself in your hands first. Because even all, like, leading with the left foot is awkward for some people. Like, right. If you're not able to do that,
like slot, the carpet sliding
over. Hey, at least the pedals are sticking.
Yeah, I just want to see Jared suffer.
Oh, come on, man.
You.
So, right, let's see, Jared. Let's see it. Let's see you go.
Yeah.
There you go.
Because that kind of like lines you up, so you sort of are communicating with your hands in a way, you know, like it lines you up.
Yeah.
Yeah.
In a really good way.
It feels so awkward.
Leading with the left foot, right? Because a lot of people would just do. Yeah. Right, left, right. And that's fine. Do whatever you want. But
because I would do that, I was trying to practice like the bleeds up.
Oh, cool.
But then, and then with the
you
right,
start with that?
The left foot
starts
really slow. But then that I feel is similar to where the right foot is doing all the work and the left foot is just filling things in.
Yeah, yeah. Because that's like a is that a herda?
Yeah.
And that's so that's right lead. Yeah. But have you ever tried playing a left-handed herda?
No,
it's so
like,
hard.
It's so weird. It's so. Like leading.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, like leading with your left foot, as awkward as it is, makes your right foot lead stronger. Because when you're playing double kick, you're playing it and you're leading with your right foot and you might be like in time, but your left foot is like, it doesn't know where it is. It's like you're kind of throwing it in there.
Yeah.
So if you like really slow it down and focus on your left foot, it strengthens like your just your single stroke roll.
Yeah.
Anytime you start with your left foot.
In Aaron Eggers' bleed lesson, he actually emphasizes leading with his left foot for that song.
Oh, really?
Sweet.
The whole song?
Yeah, the whole song, leading with the left.
That sounds like an Aaron Edgar thing.
Well, that's just because he's just ridiculous. Like, I'm just gonna re-edit this song and turn it into 2116 because why not, right?
Yeah, why not?
So challenge Dave now.
Yeah.
Make him look real.
Make
bad.
This one worse.
No, don't.
Okay, so we'll start slow. But you gotta do this too. So if you got that idea, at least you're alternating, right? We'll go really slowly at first, but. You challenge yourself by trying to see if you can maintain a single stroke roll. Can you keep going? Like, you're not doing the same thing in your feet.
Yeah. I can't do it.
I find it's really good if you visualize, because you're going and you're going one E and two E and your hands are doing one E and two E and
Right.
So I just like move my hands with my feet like. Comfortable kind of playing along while your feet are sort of going off. And I think when you incorporate leading with the left foot or at least alternating, you detach from the normal, like what you're comfortable doing.
Well, what I find is every time I force myself to lead with my left, it puts the left in the front forefront of my mind.
Yeah,
and that's the anchor now. Yeah. And when I do this one, I think two and two, right? So right, right, left, left, right, right, left,
yeah,
left.
Yeah, exactly.
Right?
Oh, I right? see.
So I think about it a little bit differently that way. One, two, one, two, one, two, one, two, one, two, one, two.
Yeah.
Everyone has their own way of internalizing it, right?
Yeah. Yeah, and you're either way, like when you're practicing drums, you're kind of just trying to, in a way, master time.
Yeah.
Like be aware of like what you're doing and not let your body like lose track, because that's really what you're practicing is like not having your body kind of betray you while you're playing, right? Yeah. Like you're just trying to line it up, not flam it. But this is very obscure in a way. I think a lot of people like wouldn't practice coordination in this way. But I feel like it made me feel really comfortable on the kit, made me like feel balanced. And I don't know, I just really enjoyed it, especially if I was like practicing on my practice pad. I would just like do a bunch of different ideas and like keep some weird pattern in the feet. Instead of just a single stroke roll, which is great too.
And then if you do threes, fives, and sevens.
Oh, okay.
Three, right, left, 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 right, left. Or you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And then going to seven, because then you're all constantly alternating and you're extending it and you're contracting it, extending it, contracting it.
Yes, yeah, yeah. And
yeah, that's another good one.
I want to look at that pattern, especially a pattern in five, because really that's a pattern in six.
Yeah.
You're one, two, three, four, five, six, one, two, three, four, five, six.
Right.
But with this one, I want to see if you guys can do a double stroke roll, because a paradiddle is actually easier. Yeah, you're good with doubles.
I don't know.
Well, if you try like the paradiddle, it also goes back and forth. That.
That was easier.
It is.
I could actually get it like that.
Cool.
Without, but not with the singles.
Singles are harder, hey?
Well, that's interesting. It's weird how your brain works like that, right?
Yeah, I think it's because it does alternate just like your feet are alternating.
Totally.
You're just not doing that double.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's because I'm doing left, right, right. If I had to hit a left here, that's when it would throw it all
off. Well, that's where you, that's why it helps you, because you're pulling a left there. Right, left, right, left, right, left.
Yeah.
Right, left, right, left, right.
Exactly.
Right? Yeah. Brilliant.
We had
Oh,
sorry. We had a great question come in from Rick D. Brick. Drumeo student, and they ask, should we practice rudiments with the double kick? I know you're doing them on the hands there, but do you ever do them with just the feet?
Yeah, actually, I'll put this on here.
This
what? Get the rudiment pad out. It's a party.
Now we're partying. Like, that's a drummer party. Right?
Yes.
When the practice pad
BYOB.
Comes.
Bring your own pad.
Oh my god. I've accepted my nerdiness.
Yes, join the club.
I do this all the time. Like I was saying before, I think it just gives me more to play or more to focus on. And because I play double kick a lot, I'm constantly thinking about not flamming. When I'm playing, because that's like.
What do you mean by flamming? Just like, for the new drummers out there, maybe just getting started, like what would that sound like?
Well, considering you know what a flam is, when you play two notes that are slightly off, when you mean to do it, it's great. And when you don't mean to do it, it's really bad.
It sounds like.
Yeah, and it's mostly a flam with like the snare and the bass.
Okay.
So if you're playing like. You want. Snare to be on the bass, and a lot of times. If it doesn't line up, it sounds really sloppy. So I am always working on, obviously, single stroke rolls. Like taking that and then kind of moving it around too. Like moving around and like working with dynamics. But for the most part, just singles and doubles, preferably for me. I don't go too hard into like paradiddles or other patterns, but I do like to line up my hands and my feet all the time when I'm practicing.
Nice. So yeah. you don't practice rudiments on your feet?
Oh, not rudiments on my feet. I did.
Okay.
A long time ago. And? I went through that process. I think I took about, like I always say, so I think I went, did the whole like stick control thing with my feet, which I don't know. I think it helped. I think the most helpful thing that I did was just work on my stamina and work on cool rhythms. I don't know. Like, I think that the stick control stuff does help, and the rudiments help my control. I was paying attention to my feet a lot, mm-hmm. and like any kind of practice when you're just focusing on your feet, I think is great. I went through that process. I did it, so I assume it did help, but I don't do that anymore so much.
Gotcha.
Yeah. Do you?
I never went through with double kick with stick control, but I know lots of drummers we've had in have done that. I know Dom Famularo.
Yeah.
He's done that. Mm. There's been a bunch of others. It's just interesting hearing like all the different perspectives, what works, totally. What doesn't. It's all different.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I think you gotta do what you're excited to do. Like,
that's a good point.
Yeah.
That's a good point.
Because you're not gonna, you can't force yourself to.
Can't wait to practice my inverted flam taps on my feet, everyone. Woohoo!
We'll let you go do that, Dave.
Hey, if you have a creative idea on how you'd like, what you'd build with that, it makes a lot of sense.
Yeah.
For sure. So.
Right now, we're gonna move into a clip actually just showing you what we have on Drumeo.
Nice.
We have so much double bass content, courses, transcriptions. We just had Simon Phillips out to do a whole double bass course. We've had Alex Rudinger, Derek Roddy, Matt Garska,
Jason Bittner.
So many great educators and performers have been out. So this is a clip here just showing you a little bit of what's inside the Drumeo members area. Check it out.
So that's what it sounds like with no click. And now we're gonna go ahead and do it with the click slowly at 60 BPM. Check it out. As you can hear there, playing it slow really helps. For me even, it's sometimes not perfectly locked in, but it's still really just gonna help you get the actual fill itself down before moving it up in tempo. But now to give you an example of it in a context a little bit faster, I'm gonna play it with the loop.
Try to find a little pulse that's going on underneath everything, and the riff itself is going da 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 da. So it's in the dun 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 dun, whatever that is, the first five notes or whatever. I just felt like a little flurry of kicks underneath it, which would be that would go really well with the kind of off time hi-hat that I'm doing there.
Yeah.
And so here it is in a slower fashion, and we'll make it work.
not everything is about speed, but I gotta tell you something. Speed is fun. I like playing fast when I need the speed. I don't always play fast, but when I want it now. So I want that ability to be inside my playing and inside my skill base so I can play it that way. So if I'm playing certain patterns with my feet, like this, I want to have the control with my feet. Check this out. Not only is there articulation, there's power, there's speed, there's control. There's a lot that's involved with that that can give you the ability of being able to express what you feel.
I'm taking this pattern and I'm throwing in some double bass, like substituting two on the double bass for the single hit. So back to the snare, it would be like this.
Glenn is such a clean drummer.
Right?
And then we have Gene Hoagland, who wore ankle weights the entire time. I'm like, is he taking those off?
Is he working out
Are you practicing while you're doing this?
He's just efficient.
He plays live like that, too.
I know.
With ankle weights.
Yeah, like the whole set. I think he like takes them off like for the last song or something, or he used to.
It must just feel like he's
walking on clouds. Like, he just flies after.
Jeez.
What do you think of that?
I bought like the atomic clock, like his.
Oh, nice.
Yeah. And I wore, like, I bought ankle weights and I wore them. And, like, I did the whole thing and it's so tiring. Yeah. Like, I think it, like, build up a little bit of stamina in there, because especially when you take them off. I think that's kind of the goal, is to take them off and feel the relief.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because it's just torture when you're playing.
There's some drummers that use, like, beater weights too, right? Have you ever tried those?
No, but I think that would be cool, because that would throw the beater in a different way. That might feel kind of, because it's not your legs like holding the weight. I would try that. I haven't tried it yet, but that sounds cool.
I was just going to ask, like, have either of you tried those, like beater weights when you're playing double kick?
Never tried the beater weights, but I did do the ankle weights for a little bit. Mm.
I am super particular about, you know, I'm not a dull bass player, but I'm super particular about
a cheater pedal.
Yes.
the weight of the beater. Mm. This is one reason I hate DW pedals, is because
they're so heavy.
The pedal feels clunky and the beater is super heavy. Mm-hmm. So it's like, I love these beaters right here.
Yeah.
And I like those beaters you're using, although they wear out pretty quick.
Yeah, they're pretty really worn out.
But I lost it.
The FP9 pedals actually come with interchangeable meter weights.
Oh, really?
Yeah, they come with two different size weights. Vatex has meter weights that come as well. Yeah, Yamaha FP9 pedals.
Well.
Which are going to come in this box?
We're giving a set of those away. Brandon doesn't want them anymore.
No, they're coming from my home straight to yours.
Okay.
Didn't even open them.
Yeah, right?
Juliet. There's this, I was watching one of Samus's videos, 6'6 Samus.
Oh, yeah.
Great drummer, great dude up from Winnipeg. And there are some comments in this video, because he's using triggers, and people are saying how lame it is that he used triggers, and it's like this whole like hater following about
not
that.
Not this again.
Why can't we talk about it?
I mean, it's been talking. All right, let's do it.
It hasn't been talked about.
We're in too deep, Dave. Like,
you're welcome to leave. I mean, I'd happily take the whole cut.
No, let's do it. Let's talk about the triggers.
Yeah, you haven't had this conversation like 1,000 times.
So I haven't.
I don't think it's cheating, because I think it's a different way of using an instrument. I don't know. I don't get why people hate on like different ways of playing.
Right. Mm. Well, I think
it's so weird to me.
What I think some people are saying, I'm just.
You're on their side.
No.
Right back.
I think people, I think some people are upset that it portrays someone as super clean and consistent when they're not actually playing super clean and consistent. But the triggers
powerful
are
too.
Yeah, powerful, yeah. And the triggers are kind of making up for it. Mm-hmm. But I mean, your bass drum's not triggered here, is it?
No.
No, and it sounds super clean.
I'm playing singles. I think with a lot of those players, they're playing double strokes.
Oh, really?
A lot of times, yeah. Have you played on a trigger? Trigger kit? Trigger bass drum?
Yeah.
A few times, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I have the EAD, so that's like, I've turned off the acoustic and just listened to the trigger.
Oh, yeah. I think with triggered playing, a lot of times, not always, they're playing double strokes. So they're really tightening up that skin and stuffing the bass drum, like, so it's almost, you don't really even need a bass drum.
Right.
It's just almost like a pad there. And they're doing a really intricate, like, motion where you're doing a double stroke roll, basically.
Yeah.
Almost like a buzz roll in a way, which is difficult to do. Like, I can't do it.
Yeah.
But I also think with, like, the style of music, it has to be loud. Like, you kind of need that trigger to pierce through. And I've seen players who use triggers, like, they can play. Like, there's people that cheat, sure, that don't sound really great without the triggers, but a lot of drummers,
you still gotta go that fast. Yeah. You still gotta hit the, even if you're not hitting it hard enough.
Yeah.
The only time I've loved triggers is when I'm in a setting where it's hard to hear.
Yeah.
And you just
monitoring.
Need, you know, the low end is so sometimes
some
impossible
rooms need
to
it.
Differentiate. Yeah, you need to have that, you know, when you're actually playing.
Do you know of a drummer called Niels Fjellstrom, I think?
Fjellstrom? Oh,
Dominator.
Yeah.
He's a left-handed drummer.
Okay.
And he plays, like, whatever.
I don't know him.
No,
it's not like whatever.
He is, like, the most awesome drummer to watch play double kick. And, like, he plays left-handed, so it's trippy to watch.
Right.
But he plays really, really fast, and he uses triggers, but he plays all the notes. You can tell he's playing with a lot of power.
Mm-hmm.
So, I don't think the triggers make you a bad player. I think it's used for a specific reason. Mm. And people could...
Are you triggered, Jared?
I'm triggered right now. I just remember in the early days of, like, when... I don't know if you remember, like, the Drumometer days.
Oh, yeah.
Where this was early internet, maybe 2005, 2006, where there was this whole thing around the world's fastest drummer, and there was just, like, such a thing, and people were, like, training big time, and Tim Watterson played with his Axis pedals, doing what you were saying.
Doubles,
but really close to the head. Yeah. He wasn't triggered because it was on a pad.
Yeah.
And he got, like, an obscene amount of strokes in 60 seconds. And he's,
the fastest
drummer, and everyone's like, you can't use that. He was a good drummer.
I remember that whole, like, who's the fastest drummer?
Yeah.
Who's the fastest, like hand?
Yeah.
It is kind of weird, but, I don't know.
Interesting time.
And nowadays, like, you listen to some albums, and it just blows you away. How did they get that speed? Like, I don't know if you heard the new Arcspire album. Like, Spencer Pruitt, some of the fastest double bass I've ever heard.
Yeah.
Like, how the hell does someone actually do that? I don't get it.
Yeah, like, how is it humanly possible?
Humanly possible.
Yeah, that's why I was, like, interested in double kick, like, to start off with. Like,
yeah.
I didn't understand.
Yeah, no doubt.
That's
awesome. I still don't understand. I still can't play like that.
You're doing just fine. Say that.
Singles are the most elusive thing to me. It's like, and I don't know if I just don't have the patience, but...
On your feet.
Yeah. My hands, I struggled. But then I kind of powered through it. But with my feet, I've never been able to do what you do.
Yeah. It's like the stamina, right? Like the repetition of it.
Mm-hmm. Like, it's just mine's just sound like this after a while.
Oh, really?
I'm fast enough.
Yeah.
Mm.
But keeping it clean.
Yeah, you have to like play for like 10 minutes straight
and
then increase the speed and play for another 10 minutes. Like.
So what do you do? Is that actually your routine?
I go through cycles. Like I'll practice different patterns, but the only thing that really helped me was just to play stamina runs, like play single stroke rolls, sometimes leading with the left foot actually, but not so much anymore. But just stamina runs and like play a beat or play singles, play rudiments on top, but just hold it for a long time until you like feel like you've like settled. Because like for the first 3 minutes when I'm playing, I actually feel uncomfortable, like I'm not warmed up, and I feel like I can't go on, and then I almost like sit into my playing, and my legs kind of relax, and then it feels like you're like flying, like it's just like your ankles are moving.
Right.
Yeah.
That's where I'm trying to get at, is like that relaxation, so that I'm not actually working hard, because I don't like to work hard.
So what do you do if you feel pain? Because I know a lot of people, they feel pain in the hips because their feet are up, or they feel pain in the front of their shins and the back of their calves.
Yeah, the like muscle that seizes up over there.
Yeah.
I don't like feeling anything, any tension in my hips. Like that, I think that's bad. You want to like maybe just like stretch or something or stand up and walk away. But like if you feel it in your calves or up here, I think that's fine. That's like your muscles are working, so you should feel it. But this is like joint pain or something. Like I don't know what that, I don't like to do that. And that's because you're using your legs. I don't want to actually use that.
It's because I'm old, right?
Yeah.
My hips.
I just turned 40, so my
hips. Yeah, bud, that's.
I got my second replacement last week.
Oh, but nice. It actually does feel like I'm trying to like push the motion down into my ankles. Like I'm not trying to move from here. So then I do feel it up here, but it doesn't hurt. It's just like tension. Right. It's the same as doing this as opposed to using your fingers. Like there's only a certain amount of, you know, speed that you can go with just your wrists.
Yeah.
So you want to like push it down into your ankles, I guess.
I mean, it's super extreme. You use your toes even too.
Yeah.
Your fingers, right?
Like you're just going to use your toes to play? Show us, Dave.
Take your shoes off.
The toes, right? Right there. People always forget about the toes.
Put your shoe back on.
People always forget about the toes.
If you're gonna, something stinks.
If you're gonna play slide technique or anything, toes are so important. It's like your fingers. You don't forget about your fingers when you're playing your stacks. You don't forget about your toes.
Love it.
Come on.
No one's
Give it the time.
No one's with you.
No one.
We, no.
Three against one.
Yeah, well, sometimes you guys can learn a few things.
we'll set up a lesson, Dave. Right now, we've got one more clip we want to show from our featured coach for the month of June, Simon Phillips. Incredible, legendary drummer who played with Judas Priest, Toto, The Who, so many others. And he did a great lesson breaking down the double bass shuffle in a Jeff Beck tune called Space Boogie. So we're going to check that out right now.
So, the double bass drum shuffle. Well, I first heard this played by Billy Cobham on Spectrum, and the tune was called Quadrant 4, and I was just mesmerized by it. I also didn't know what he was doing. So I listened, and I tried to play it, and then I finally figured out how to play it. I went, that's what's going on. So let me play a little bit of just the regular 4-4 fast shuffle, okay? So it's very important that you're playing a shuffle on the kick drums and not even. So it's got to be and not. That's the first thing, but it's also what the, well, my right hand is doing, maybe your left hand is doing, which is filling in the gaps with the triplets. Like that. So I'll play it very slowly.
is so good.
It's so clean.
I still and Kyle told me that he didn't like it, but his performance on Dancing Men with the double bass, that's like what got
me.
That's probably what got me into playing double bass, just singles. On the Burning for Buddy album.
Yeah.
You ever heard it?
No, actually. I haven't heard that.
Yeah, it's a great album filled with amazing drummers.
Yeah. And he doesn't like his performance in it.
Apparently he did. It was rushed. He didn't want to do that too.
It is the whole day.
But it's the first track on the album, and it's incredible. Yeah.
It's so funny when you hear the backstory of like, oh, you didn't like that track or that day or whatever. And for us, it's like this super important performance.
Yeah.
But
it's forever burned in my memory and my inspiration. He's like, oh, that was shit.
Yeah, because he hasn't probably since it came out, right?
Your taste is horrible.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Well, we're going to give away some stuff. We're going to give away a membership.
Yes.
A one-year membership.
One-year membership to...
Someone on YouTube.
Someone on YouTube. And what do you want to give away?
Give away the pedals.
Should we give away a QuietKick on YouTube as well?
Sure.
Sure. Yeah.
Because so for those that don't know, Colin, if you don't mind just getting in here, this is our new Drumeo QuietKick. It's available for sale now. We have a few. We don't have any double pedal versions left, meaning it comes with two beaters. But this actually just pops off. Mm-hmm. And this is the unit, right? And so I hook this up to my double pedal, like so, and attach the hold on. It's not going well here. and then this thing actually comes off too. So it comes with a bunch of different pads. Sorry, Colin. Nick, you're up here, Colin. Okay. But you can get them now. There might be a link somewhere.
Yeah.
Or just search QuietKick, but we'll give one away.
Honestly, I gotta say, the last hour here where we've been live, I've been sitting on the couch. I would do this watching the movie. Put your pedals down like this. Mm-hmm. You can just like, seriously.
Dude, I have this. This is perfect. I have this unit and with the quiet pad set up in my living room.
Yeah,
nice.
You know what? Like, this is amazing.
It's a permanent fixture. My kids sit down and they just like wail on them all the time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's portable.
Yeah. Small.
Yeah. Yeah. It's not this big.
Throw it in a backpack and take it wherever.
Yeah. You can hide it under the couch when you're done. You're good to go.
Yeah. So we're going to give away the QuietKick and a membership to the same...
Two different things.
Two different giveaways.
Two different giveaways.
Julia's going to choose.
I am choosing a random person now.
Okay, first question from you. This is going to be for YouTube for the one-year membership.
Okay.
Well, I don't know how difficult it should be. Either name all three drummers that have ever played in death, or at least one.
One drummer
and
death.
One is easy.
All three. All three.
To look. Do you know?
Right.
I don't know the drummers.
Do you want me to
who's going
to
know?
Yeah, you got to
look. Or at least two out of the three.
Let's do, the question is, who is the drummer that played on Symbolic?
Symbolic, okay.
By death. The album we talked about earlier.
You're just good. Yeah.
And Rowan, if you see in the chat.
Oh, should I see if it's...
Yeah.
Oh, shit, where did it start? I think someone already said it.
I'm looking through.
It keeps going.
No, it was not Neil Peart.
Just the first, Julia, the first one you see is fine. Like, whoever you choose that got it right.
Yeah, it's
if it was the first or not, it doesn't matter. What matters is
Julia's
choice.
Matthew Lacey, I believe.
Matthew Lacey.
Congratulations.
Send me an email, brandon@drumeo.com. We'll throw it in the YouTube chat, and we'll make sure that gets sent to you. Or I guess this is the membership.
That's the membership.
Yeah. So email me. We'll get that activated for you.
He's like, oh, damn. I want to.
Yeah.
Now the membership's good.
Okay. Now the QuietKick. We need to...
With the loud pedal.
With the loud pedal.
We're going to give that away after.
Oh, my goodness.
It's the heavy foot.
Julia, do you have a second question for us? For a lucky winner?
Are we picking like a letter and a number?
So just give me one letter.
I.
I? Okay, now give me another letter.
X.
I,
oh,
X.
Come on.
You're choosing the hardest one.
B.
I, X, B. I'm looking for someone that has I, X, B in their username.
Someone goes.
If you have letter.
No, you can't post it in the chat. It has to be in your username.
Yeah, smart, though. That's
music great. X.
Oh, the Music Explorer almost had it. He almost had it. Just didn't have a B in there.
Who has IXB?
I'll buy B for
Felix,
300.
Chris Felix?
Someone changed their username code.
Well, that's fine if you want to
I'm
do
sure
that.
Someone will.
Who has IXB?
We're not leaving until we find someone with IXB.
You chose this. I hope I'm not
going.
Julia's never going to come back.
I'll do, okay, drum roll here.
We might be here a while, Dave.
No, nothing. No one has eye
equity. Okay, okay.
Nothing, hey?
I bet you someone's quickly trying to create an account.
Or an X.
Yeah. Someone says, the IXB is silent in my name, so I left it out.
Okay, you know what? You said X, so I'm going to go with that. The Music Explorer.
Yeah, he's got it.
He says, nice. Yamaha
or
DX.
She. Sorry.
So, Music
there
Explorer.
Go. Nice good, yeah. Good job for having us.
Congratulations.
I like, yeah, exactly.
It's great. It's send me an email, brandon@drumeo.com. We'll throw it in the chat once more,
X.
But we'll make sure the QuietKick gets sent off to you.
It's good. It actually made it easier to choose.
Yeah. Otherwise, like, yeah, that's a good point.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay.
Members.
Members for.
Hold on. Is Julia playing another song?
At the end.
Maybe we
what?
We should hold it back. That's lame to do.
Jared, you're a savage.
I am savage.
Savage.
No, let's do it.
It's right here, ready to give away.
So Julia's gonna play us out.
Yeah. So we're gonna give away the pedal. Then Julia's gonna play.
Yeah.
What tune are you gonna play?
If someone can guess, they can guess.
Guess the Megadeth song Julia's gonna play.
Should I try to say what it is?
Yeah, you should say a song. We'll do that giveaway another way, Brandon.
Sounds good.
How do you want to do it?
I want to do a double bass history question.
Let's do it.
For members.
Okay.
So, who is credited as being the first double bass drummer? And this is for Drumeo members. I'm watching the chat.
Here it comes.
Pressure's on.
Come on.
Percussion.
KP Percussion.
Congratulations.
KP.
And big thanks to Yamaha, because we asked them to support this stream.
Like a few days ago or something.
A few days, and with all the shipping delays and everything going on in the world with stuff, they were kind enough to send this out. And they've always been super supportive. So that's a Yamaha FP9 double pedal. This is a Yamaha, is this the Oak Hybrid?
The kit?
Live.
The Live Oak Hybrid?
Yeah.
What do you think of this kit, Julia?
It's awesome.
It's great,
yeah.
Hey?
Yeah, super comfy.
Beautiful kit.
I like the wood grain on it, too.
Yeah, definitely. Mm-hmm.
Nice.
Awesome.
Jared's wearing a Yamaha underpants.
Nice.
Can't see him, but he is wearing them.
Yeah. How do you know?
Let's give it up for Julia.
Yeah.
Julia, what song are you going to play?
I'm going to play Five Magics.
Five Magics.
Ooh, and then
after that, we're going to shut it right down.
Yeah.
So thank you all so much for coming out. This is International Drum Month. This stream is part of that. Julia, thank you for coming out and being a part of
that. That's great.
Julia has other content on Drumeo, as well as some unreleased footage that will be
coming
soon. Uh-huh. And we have lots more planned for this month when it comes to streams. Steve Smith is coming out.
Yeah, next, we're live every Thursday around this time. You can check the Drumeo channel for all of it, but Steve Smith is out next week, Todd Sukerman the following week, and then we've got a big wrap-up drum hang at the end of the month. So.
Like a multi-hour stream where we're gonna...
I think so.
Let's do
it. There'll be lots of drummers, lots of drums.
Yeah.
I'm assuming more giveaways.
Yeah, oh, for sure. We'll give away Dave's snare drum collection.
And his phone number.
And his phone number.
I'm out of here, guys. Thank you, Julia.
Yeah. Thanks, Julia.
Cheers.
Take care.
Bye.